with a definite definition, but come close to it. What artistic research is, but from a historical perspective, from the historical tradition of modern art. And that's part of this paper, is part of this research. The aim of this presentation is to introduce a possible definition of artistic research derived in the historical tradition of modern art. It is based on an analysis of the Nietzschean, Bergsonian, the Lucian complex of intuition, taking as a working paradigm Duchamp's description of the creative process, and especially his concept of the art coefficient. This paper aims to show how the Lucian's concept of the art as a dark precursor is both a development and an affirmation of the metaphysics that underlies this tradition. Number one, lightnings of intuition. In his 1873 book, Philosophy in the Age of the Greeks, Nietzsche presents intuition as a tripartite process of the mind that leads to the creation of new and fecund philosophical knowledge. In his description, Nietzsche conjures up the image of lightning to describe the instantaneous action by which the flying mind, equipped with the wings of imagination, discharges itself upon a resting place and evaluates the potential of the discovered ground to become a new being. What this philosophy leaps ahead on tiny two holes. Hope and intuition lend wings to its feet. Calculating reason lumbers heavily behind, looking for better footballs. However, there come times when reason cannot move further. It's heavy, as Nietzsche says, lumbers heavily behind. So it becomes also paralyzed before a rushing stream of water. A heavy problem. It is then impelled to move ahead by the power of imagination. But again, its feet are propelled by an alien illogical power, the power of creative imagination. Imagination is a power that unlocks a mind from the grip of gravity, the grip of reasoning, and allows it to take it off, to take off, as it were, flying on the potential resting places or possibilities of perception. Then at some point in its reviewing flight, imagination will sense a place it sees from afar, and may have a greater potential as a spatial location for rest and discovery in the sexual knowledge. Nietzsche calls the capacity to see in advance the potential of a situation creative premonition. This would be a capacity to actually create a place such that it will have the greatest possibility for future philosophical growth. Again, Nietzsche from the philosophy of the French Age of the Greeks. Lifted by imagination, philosophical thinking leaps from possibility to possibility, using each one as a temporary resting place. Occasionally, it will grasp such a resting place even as it flies. Creative premonition will show the place. Imagination guesses from afar that here it will find a demonstrable resting place. Once premonition has pointed to such a place, imagination sets immediately to work by what Nietzsche calls the It's a lightning, quick seizure and illumination of analogies, which eventually lead to careful revision by reasoning. Lightning, quick seizure and illumination of analogies. When the analogy proves to have the power to bring together two differences through a link that identifies them, the resting place becomes a foothold. That is to say, it can become a being, a concept. Just to say a note, Nietzsche employed this. The metaphor of the image of the lightning more than once in his writings. In one of the letters that was published by her sister, when he talks about inspiration, he describes it as like lightning, a thought flashes forth, insensitive in his form, and without a shadow of turning. I never had any choice. Also, he describes, in Zarathustra describes himself as a lightning that falls down humanity. It is possible to extend Nietzsche's image of the work of intuition as a lightning discharge to seize the illuminating analogies contained in a place by considering that the path of this lightning is first explored in near simultaneous time by a series of dark precursors that precede it. So you know, Deleuze describes the dark precursors as explorers, sent forth to examine and establish the path of the most efficiently connecting multiplicities. One of these precursors establishes the pathway for the discharge. Quote, thunderbolts flowed between different entities that they are perceived by the visible, exactly like this precursor, which determines their path in advance. Nietzsche, in the previous, the way he describes intuition, points out that lightning, that the lightning discharge illuminates the analogies between the terms. But the less clarifies that such analogies are simple optical illusions caused by the blinding light of the bolt itself as it falls. They are actually interpretations based on reverse perceptions made out of a habit of representation. Through them, through analogies, we want to see at least minimal identity and resemblance between two systems in order to grasp one of them. It's possible to say that as a differentiator, the dark precursor establishes the differences between the systems, but its effect is then hidden by the power of the discharge that blinds the eye and brings into effect the usual analogy. In fact, the controller in the list would come to be considered in the evaluation of analogies. Small or large differences between the terms is in reality the result of the capacity of the differentiator to displace and disguise itself. What appears as a large or small resemblance in the outside is the illusion expressed in the exterior world. Whereas a large or small difference in respect of phenomena internal to the process of discharge related to how, in the using Bergson's terms, the dark cluster was not measured during the duration of the process of knowledge creation. And I'm going to talk to Duchamp, and then I'm going to bring back to this process of intuition. The art creation. In the creative art, the published text of a 1957 lecture, Duchamp gave in the United States, where he analyzes in retrospective the creative process of the artist. Duchamp states that this process is guided by intuition and inevitably conditioned by difference. While the most fundamental aspect of this analysis can be traced back to the Nietzschean concept of artistic genius, later notes also demonstrate his depth of Bergson's method of intuition and his analysis of the creative power inherent in time. Duchamp's description of the creative process as a struggle between the analogy of representation and difference itself can both illustrate the work of the dark precursor and help us clarify the potential definition of artistic research. When Duchamp described the creative act of the artist by saying that, quote, to all appearances, the artist acts like an idealistic being who, from the labyrinth beyond time and space, seeks his way out to equilibrium, unquote, Duchamp was in fact describing Nietzsche's concept of the true artist, artist with genius. In the Greek of Tragedy, Nietzsche described the artist as an individual who is able to overcome his own egotistic subjectivity in order to come into contact with the genius of the world, and the God who is already released and redeemed from the individual will and becomes, it were, a medium. The challenge for which the only true existence celebrates his release and redemption through semblance. In the same way, Duchamp states that the artist's actions are not guided by conscious decisions, but by pure intuition, which is gained in the return of the artist from the labyrinth beyond space and time. The Dionysian collapse, which is the collapse of the Principium di Liberationis, of Schopenhauer's concept for the Dionysian, or from undifferentiated in the framework of the community. On this return, in that collapse, the artist is free to engage difference, and it must face difference, and produce completely new entities as a way to differentiate the one into multiple. And once in possession of this pure intuition, which is, as Nietzsche described, the means of imagination powered by creative emotion, which signals to a potentially new aesthetic being in this light, the artist then enters into a process, second step of the process, leading to the actualization in matter of the intuitive vision. Imagination saw as a resting place, as Nietzsche describes it. Grasp, then has to be brought into the matter, the artistic process. I shall attempt to show that this process characterized by Duchamp as a real struggle, and quote, a series of efforts, pains, satisfaction, refusals, decisions, which also cannot and must not be fully self-conscious, at least not in the aesthetic plane, quote, tries to shed in this is an element that is crucial to this research made by the artist on this struggle. The fact that the work of art will never, no matter how much it's a struggle, no matter it will always, will never have actually an identity with the initial intention of the artist. That is to say, the difference between the intuition of the artist and the actual art will always be a difference. Duchamp called this difference between what the artist intended to realize and did realize, the personal art coefficient of the artist. This coefficient, this irreducible difference inherent to the artwork, has nothing to do, Duchamp points out, with the good or bad quality of the artwork. It's not a condition for judgment. It's simply something inherent to the artwork, the process, the creative process. However, the struggle of the artist, his research is totally focused on reducing that condition to a minimum, that is to say, to bring in the greatest identity between intuition and realized real form. Great. The twofold work of intuition. I'm going to focus a bit more about this intuitive process. The Duchamp description of the creative process can be considered as a twofold work of intuition. On the first unfolding, immediately after the breakdown of subjective differentiation, the artist engaged in a return flight where she or he looks for a clearing, a resting place described by Nietzsche, which results in the grasping of a new vision or concept that hereafter will guide the efforts of the artist. This is way then to the second unfolding of intuition when it works toward actualizing the concept as material form in the exterior world. In the first unfolding, intuition starts its flight propelled by the use of imagination. During its flight, it sends out a series of dark precursors to establish the path of greatest difference between the given series of interiorized multiples and other multiplicities. The dark precursor finds a mosaic path that will bring two systems in a differential relation to one another. Once the systems have been related to difference, there follows a blinding lightning as an instant recognition of an apparent analogy between the two systems. And this whole flight, as Nietzsche concept can be called as can be described also as the Bergsonian duration, where at all times the images are present in memory and are constantly differentiated by dark precursors in order to generate different the principium individuationis, the differentiated conscience, so that since Bergson there is on the one hand a multiplicity of successive states of consciousness, and on the other a unity which binds us together. Duration will be the synthesis of this unity and multiplicity. Duchamp analyzes Nietzschean Bergsonian complex of intuition in one of his notes, where he points out that Nietzsche's eternal return, is the instantaneous return of all images into conscience in the moment where he has to differentiate the individuality, the new resting place. I want to read this note from Duchamp. Each fraction of duration, all future and antecedent fractions are reproduced. All these past and future fractions thus coexist in a present which is really no longer what usually calls the instant present, but sort of present of multiple extension. See, it's just eternal return, the vastenic form of a repetition in succession to infinity. That's it. So we can say then that this first unfolding of intuition happens in the time of Kronos, for as Duchamp points out, it happens in a duration without present, where only the past is brought into play in order to be differentiated from the potential futures, the new resting places. That's the first unfolding. In the second unfolding of intuition, the artist works to project the differentiated repetition, the intuitive vision before it into a given form. Here the work becomes that of differentiated intensities produced by the materials that the artist handles. And therefore, in order to establish the highest degree of apparent resemblance between an external form, the material, and the interior concept, this is the greatest struggle for the artist, for as Duchamp points out, the difference between the intended and the realized will also be present. So we can say that this second unfolding happens in the time of Aaron, When the artist is forced to confront and differentiate in a constant present the material experience. This is a duration of successive states of consciousness where intensities are constantly differentiated, with an actor also working to establish the most direct path between an intensity and a multiple or idea. The concept. This is what Duchamp can describe with this series of efforts, pain, satisfaction, and fusal decisions. And there is again, and finally, also, as in the priest lightning, that illuminates an analogy that is a resemblance between a given intensity, a material form, and the priest. So finally, the artwork is born. However, what is crucial in this process, in the second process, is that the darker course of work has not been entirely hidden, but is sparse and obliterated by the lightning that establishes resemblance. This is because, on the one hand, the intention of the work of art, the first, the idea, the concept, was developed as a subjective process in the Bergsonian sense, that is, as a qualitative, non-numerical multiplicity that is completely and adequately known. On the other hand, the actualization of the work of art as a material form is an objective numerical multiplicity. Bergson applies the objective to what is known in such a way that a constantly increasing number of new impressions could be substituted for the idea that we actually have of it. This constant substitution with different interpretations of the object is the fact that makes the actual work of art always different from the idea of the concept which the artist has to. This is the reason also why Duchamp points out that the spectator who can project his own impressions into the artwork and thereby produce his own subjective valorization of it. That's the way the spectator completes the work. Thus, the dark precursor which differentiated the intensity of forms into the artwork cannot be completely hidden because it is not possible to assimilate it as a perfect analogy. The lightning that created this analysis is strong to my mind to the fact that it is still different of work in the actualization. I come now to the conclusion, artistic research. Artistic research happens therefore in two levels. On the one hand, it takes place in the time of Chronos as a duration that affirms the tenor of the term and produces a subjective, qualitative multiplicity that constitutes the idea of artwork. On a second level, artistic research happens also in an aeonic time as an actualization of the idea in an object that accepts a multiplicity of interpretations. As such, the artwork, the material artwork, contains difference itself inherently, and this difference, as Duchamp points out, has nothing to do with the judgment of good or bad, pardon the banner of this. It is rather difference in itself which makes the work of art a natural multiplicity constantly differentiated and a kind of living in the world. Thank you very much.
So that's pretty, it should be for the next presentation.